were extremely interested in bettering the community wherever they were. They were servants, public servants.
Ooh, good. You're warming me up.
I was born in Cambridge, Massachusetts, but grew up in Hanover, New Hampshire, which is a nice small college town, kind of like Danville. And my dad was a doctor there. My mom was a super volunteer. I was involved in a lot of things in high school, yes. Tennis, cheerleading, Latin club, French club. My mother was a very dominating personality. You know, my mother ruled the roost when it came to lots of things. She was a force to be reckoned with, she was. And when she criticized you, you felt it. But, I mean, she let us, my sister and me, do lots of things which most parents wouldn't let them do. I mean, when I wanted to go to Nigeria with the Rotary Club, she said, fine. And, she just let me grow. I'm grateful for that. Not all parents have the courage to do that. She lived in New Haven, Connecticut, and she worked with the Italian low-income community, and then she also was the children's librarian. I mean, she was just full of variety, and she just wanted to make her contributions. My dad was a devoted doctor. He used to take me to see patients sometimes, but he had a little conservative side. It was not great, but he said, you should not go to medical school and take up the place of somebody who's going to practice all his life. He said, if you go to medical school, you will just get married and will not practice. And he said, I think it's too important for you to do that. I was influenced by what he said. So then I got interested in social issues and political issues, which they were also interested in. I went to Smith College in Northampton, Massachusetts. It was an all-girls college, which was not freakish in those days. The main New England Ivy League universities were all male. And then there were this group of colleges called the Seven Sisters, which were all female. And I went to Smith, and I really liked it. I learned a lot of leadership skills there. I also liked Smith because they had a program called Junior Year Abroad. I met my husband really when I was pretty young, and he was a big star because he was a skier, already a national figure in the ski world. And everybody knew who he was. Ralph Miller was just our local hero. And in 1956, before the Olympics, he was the great hope for the American ski team in Europe, in Cortina, and he was on the cover of Sports Illustrated. I was teaching in a private school for 2 years, French and history I taught. It was called the Westover School. I did that because I didn't know what to do when I graduated from college. I wanted to do something interesting and important and significant, but I didn't know what it was going to be. We had a wonderful courtship, and he asked me to marry him, and I said, I'm too young, I'm not ready yet. And then he asked me a year later, well, I think actually I was going out with him about a year later, and I said, don't you want to marry me anymore? So he said, well, of course. So, we had a nice courtship, and we were married up in Maine, where my parents and grandparents had a little summer house. He was in the Olympics in 56 and did most of his skiing in the 50s. And by 1959 and 60, he'd gone to medical school and was pursuing that. In 1962, that's when Ralph and I were married, and we moved to Washington, D.C. We just loved that experience there. We continued to live there until 65, when we moved to Boston for Ralph to do some more study. I had a half-time job at an organization in Boston called ABCD, which was the anti-poverty program there. So I worked at the anti-poverty program. They wanted me to write grants. So I learned how to write grants, and I got them some money from the Washington agencies that were supporting the local anti-poverty programs. At the end of 69, we moved to California, where he was going to do some research with a colleague about his endocrinology interests. But Ralph had taken a job at the University of Kentucky Medical Center in the pharmacology department. And here we were, and we bought a house and settled in. I remember well arriving in Lexington. We drove into town with three little children. By then we'd had a baby, Karen, and we drove in, and downtown Lexington was in the middle of urban renewal. It was very dusty, and there were a lot of buildings that were being torn down, and I said, Ralph, look at this downtown. It's a real mess. The first thing I did in Lexington that I think led me to believe it was a great place to work and provide public service was I started this little farmers market in the place where Triangle Park is now. I went to the Urban Renewal Board and found a site where we could have a farmers market. I went to the health department and asked for permits to do that, and that was my first my first run-in with bureaucracy. The man who was head of public health there said, no, you can't start a farmer's market. There'll be flies and rats there, and it will be, you know, bad for people's health. And I said, what? I was astonished by that. And so, not realizing how things worked around here, I just said, well, I'll find out who the boss is at the health department, and I'll go talk to him. Then he saw me, he said, oh, certainly, he said, we'd love to have a farmer's market. He said, I can overrule that fellow, and he did. At the beginning, they didn't know how to set up at all. You know, they brought in tomatoes in paper bags and would, you know, put them on a table. So it wasn't a site that was developed at all for them.
Read an article in the Herald Leader about a farmer's market starting in Lexington. So I went over the following week, and I met Pam. She was an enthusiastic person herself, and she generated enthusiasm among some of the other people as well. And all of us that first summer were growers, and I think that was important. We were all growers. Later on, it became something of a pinhooker's market.
I think Pam started the farmer's market because she wanted a place to shop. I'm not sure Pam could have imagined all that when she first started it, but she is the one.
It started small, and it got bigger the next year and bigger the next year, and look what it is today. It's beautiful. In 1973, some of the people that I'd worked with on the merger campaign and some people I'd worked with also on the farmers market, they came to me and said, why don't you run for one of these new seats in the new government? And I said, well, I don't know. I don't know much about it. But I was intrigued with the idea, and I just didn't know it couldn't be done. And of course, there were no incumbents because it was a brand new government with 15 seats. And the district that we lived in, which is right here where we still live, it was kind of the university district. So it was going to be a more forward-looking district in terms of accepting somebody like me from out of town. And I worked hard. I went to every single house in the spring in May, knocking on doors in the rain and everything else. And you'll have to excuse me for smiling about this part. There were eight people in that race, and in the May primary, I got 50% of the vote, and the seven guys that were also running got the other 50%. So I was sort of shocked and pleased and thought, well, this seems to be something I can do. In my 1973 fall election, the first one, my opponent ran an ad in the paper saying that I was a carpetbagger and I should stay home and take care of my children. Because I had three children at that point. And so that made me mad, of course.
With the good old boy network that existed in Lexington, I'm not so sure how welcome she was. And I can say that because I know what it feels like to not be welcome into a setting.
One of the other ways that Pam really figured in my life is that she demonstrated by her success in local politics, despite being from the Northeast, that I didn't have to worry about that. I come from the Northeast like she does, but it was never a thought in my mind if I wanted to be active politically that it would be a handicap, because there she was, vice mayor, being very successful.
There were about 100 people that ran for office all over Lexington, ran for those 15 positions. And there were about five or six other women that ran from some of those districts, but none of them were elected. So the council makeup was 14 men and me.
We all know that she was the first. You know, Pam has a legacy of being first. She was one of the first women to serve in that capacity.
Sometimes people would discount me for being female, and I think that actually annoyed me more than anything people ever said. You know, women still go through this today. I mean, you're sitting in a group and you come out with an idea and nobody pays any attention to it, and then a man says virtually the same thing, you know, 10 minutes later, and everybody said, oh, that's a good idea. During the 70s, some more women came on the council, which was really wonderful for me. I got to work on things that were more than just district issues, but were really community issues, like the Children's Museum or the Kentucky Theater after the fire and that kind of thing. In 77, I took a break from the council because my husband took a sabbatical and went to Geneva, Switzerland for a year to do research. And so I pulled myself up from the council. I resigned the end of 1977 from my second term and went to Switzerland with our three kids and had a fabulous experience over there as a family. When we came back, I said to myself, you know, I had a great time when I was on the city council. I think I'll go back and try to do that again and run for office again instead of messing around with this state bureaucracy, which I obviously do not get along in. I ran for an at-large seat in 1979 or 80, something like that. Because I had done a respectable job on the council, other women started to be interested in running and thinking that they could make the grade.
Pam was an amazing role model and had a huge influence on my decision to run for the city council. She had been there, she had done it, she was a trailblazer, and she was an amazingly supportive friend in the process, introducing me, like other young women, to a network of people that we would not have been able to have known had it not been for her.
When I became mayor, which happened actually when Scotty Basler, my predecessor, went to Washington, I actually coasted into the mayor's job the first year. That November election was a great start for me in the mayor's office because I'd been involved in so many positive projects and things during that time. The next two or three years were eventful years.
Early in Pam's mayoral career, tremendous challenges, very, very quickly, bam, 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 you have this snowstorm that paralyzed vehicles on the interstate all the way to the terrible incident with the shooting of Tony Sullivan.
Pam, to her credit, was she stood very tall during those times. I know it had to be very, very stressful because as a community, we were on the national stage. What we, those of us in the African-American community, appreciated about her was her sensitivity. And I think that some of that probably had to do with her northern upbringing versus the southern antebellum kind of attitude that was real here in this community during the 60s and 70s.
In 1998, I had to run for a re-election. It was very tight. I felt really good that I'd prevailed in spite of all these difficulties. And the public sort of was okay with it too. Well, she's here, we've got her and she's here. So I had a really great time that last term. It was a time when I felt that we really made a lot of progress for the city. I also spent a lot of time with children's issues. Those were programs like Partners for Youth and after school programs and a wonderful summer program we had called Summer Shades for middle school kids.
There's going to be a little bit of a void with a lot of these organizations that she's been a part of, and she's been that thread throughout the whole community and even into the state about people that want to do the right thing, they want to make change, they want to make positive change, and we're going to miss that with Pam. But Pam was one of the original 30 people that made up this Blue Ribbon panel back in the early 1980s that really started the movement for reform in Kentucky in education. It started with higher education, then it moved to all education.
She served in the Opera Board and in the Council on Post-Secondary Education and with the Pritchett Committee. She basically continued to give back to the community.
When you're mayor, you end up building a lot of buildings, but there was one building that I was particularly interested in bringing to reality, and that's the Downtown Arts Center.
That building got renovated, I think most people would say, primarily because she was so interested in getting it done, despite all the difficulties. And it's been a great contribution to the continuing improvements in downtown. So the renaming of the Downtown Arts Center as the Pam Miller Downtown Arts Center is the most visible evidence of the way in which the community values what she did. She's been identified not just with the Downtown Arts Center, but also with a wide variety of arts. She's known as an enthusiast for the arts. She is a patron. She's been supportive in so many ways.
It's going to be very, very upsetting to leave Lexington, because Lexington's been very good to us. Very, very. I love it. I love Lexington. And I've put a lot of effort into it, and I have a lot of wonderful friends here.
When I think of Pam Miller, I think of something that Ralph Waldo Emerson said. And he said, the purpose of life is not to be happy. It's to be useful, to be honorable, to be compassionate, so that you have made some difference and lived well. That is Pam Miller to me.